Are we waiting for the president? Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sure you enjoyed lunch, and I'm more than eager to continue with the conference because the latter part of it all is really aimed at making a grand finale to all the wonderful discussions we've had so far today. A call to action, and I know you really all are going to want to get involved. Good news, the hashtag IWD2016. So any comments or questions that you post on Twitter, if you add that hashtag, you're now going to have a little icon, a little symbol of that particular hashtag, International Women's Day. So that's really, really exciting. I think we will definitely be trending by the end of this conference. Now, a good way just to ease us into the rest of the discussions is a special message. This from a former Deputy President of South Africa. She's the Executive Director of UN Women. And at that point, when she was the Deputy President of South Africa, she was the highest ranking woman in the history of South Africa. We are extremely proud of her. Phumzile Mlambo Ngcuka. Here's a message from the UN.
Greetings from New York and happy International Women's Day. I congratulate FIFA for holding this important conference with so many remarkable women and men who are pushing the envelope on women's leadership in sports. This conference comes at a crucial time, a time of reform for FIFA and the football world, with opportunities for real change. Women and girls in sports are more visible and more vocal today than at any point in history. Whether on the tennis court or the football field, whether as professionals or enjoying an after-school activity, women and girls athletes show what can be gained through sports. Sports can break barriers and challenge discriminatory stereotypes. It can teach some of life's biggest lessons about equality, teamwork, resilience, and fairness. Yet women are highly underrepresented in the leadership of sporting organizations, including FIFA and in federations, sports outfitters, and marketers. This is a deficit in terms of fair play, but also it is not smart business. As many industries have increasingly recognized, women widen perspectives and bring in new ideas and innovations and improve business. At UN Women, we welcome the chance to work with FIFA and all of you to implement the recommendations of the Reform Committee. FIFA, its member associations, and sports federations can and must remove barriers to decision-making positions, empower women to take on leadership roles, and ensure full equality, including equal pay. We must put women and men on an equal playing field. I wish all of you a good meeting. And thank you.
Thank you, Siyabonga Mamlambo Ngcuka, for those wonderful words. And echoing her sentiments is her colleague at UN Women, the Director of Strategic Partnerships. We're about to hear from her right now, focusing on the need to continue to contest the stereotype. Looking forward, championing new progressive equal norms. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Kristin Hetle.
Thank you. I think this is a new world to me, the world of sports. I could pretend that I'm familiar with it, but I think I would be found out real quickly. So it's better to fess up. It's really, when I was a little girl, I was a bookworm, and there were no women football players. that I could look up to anyway in my home country, Norway. Later, as those of you, as many of you know, Norwegian women footballers have made great strides and taken many victories. I'm the lucky one to be able to be here with you today, since my executive director had to stay behind in New York since it's International Women's Day tomorrow, and her calendar is very full on those days. It's been so inspiring already today to hear from, I'm glad I'm coming this late in the program because I feel like a sponge. I've been absorbing. And just to hear people like Billie Jean King and Annie Saidi, who in different ways, but in the same ways, have been and are, still are trailblazers, and taking also on the considerable burden, I imagine, personal burden, to stand in the storm and in the trenches with a lot of pushback. Here, everyone is among friends. You all know that that's not always the case, and many of you are really out there fighting for girls' and women's rights and possibilities in the field of sports, and for that I really salute you. Thank you so much to FIFA for inviting you and women here today. We feel very privileged to be part of this important conference that comes at a crucial time in the history of FIFA and football. And speaking of history, Donna, you mentioned briefly earlier here, and I learned this last night at the dinner table, and I had never heard about it before. Maybe you all know about it, and it's just my ignorance, but actually these women who were playing football in 1920s England, they were drawing masses of audiences, up to 50,000. And it was not just that the men came back from the First World War that made them withdraw. They were actually forbidden to continue. The Football Association, or should I say, the Male Football Association, clearly saw them as very threatening, so they banned them from all arenas and stadiums, and this ban lasted for 50 years. And can we just imagine for a second what women's football would look like today if that had not happened, if there had been that evolution and evolvement from the 1920s until today? I think we would have had a very, very different picture. So, and I wish in the beautiful new museum of FIFA, I encourage the museum to bring about more of the women's football history in its exhibitions, because I felt that was a little bit lacking in the tour yesterday. And I'm sure there is so much fascinating history to unearth and to expose. And where better to expose it than at the FIFA Museum? I want to congratulate President Infantino on his election to head FIFA into this new critical era. Challenges are manifold. Change is needed, and the hopes of millions of football fans worldwide are high that football governance becomes more transparent, balanced, inclusive, and equal. And as he himself said, without commitment from the top, or the commitment from the top is needed, and someone else had said, without commitment from the top, change will not happen. So I'm glad that he has said this publicly, because it also means that he can be held to account. I would also like to congratulate, as several of you have done before me, the FIFA Congress on passing the much-needed reform package. It comes at a crucial time and will be game-changing at many levels to equal the playing field of football. It will especially be game-changing. This is the problem when you start getting old and you need glasses and then you don't need them and then the distance is too long, and I'm struggling a little bit here, as you can see. Ah, there. Where was I? It will especially be game-changing to increase women's participation in football governance, which will benefit everyone. This would not have been possible without FIFA's Women's Football Task Force, who I would like to acknowledge on behalf of UN Women for its outstanding leadership in this area. Along with partners and all the athletes who signed a joint letter, the tireless lobbying and persistence resulted in a more inclusive reform package that brings the number of women at the decision-making table to an historic high. Congratulations. But this is just the beginning. Now the hard work starts to implement the reforms, including those on women's participation. The adoption of the reforms offered the opportunity to correct the most profound and systemic injustice in sport, namely underrepresentation of women in sports leadership and under-resourcing of their participation. With this in mind, barriers to decision-making positions need to be removed, and women must be empowered to take on leadership roles. All sports federations should put women and men in this and all other respects on an equal playing field. Temporary special measures, as we call it in UN speak, such as quotas, have proven to be invaluable tools in different leadership spheres, whether it is in the world of sports, in the parliament, or in the boardroom. Worldwide today, one of five parliamentarians are women. 20%, 22%, one in five. It's not very many, but it's many more than just 10 years ago, or 20 years ago, sorry, when it was one in 10. And this increase is largely due to parliamentary reforms and the use of quotas. Without such measures, women's representation would be even worse. Most countries that apply quotas have set them to 30% to be most effective, and this was also alluded to earlier today. If the number and or the percentage is too small, you really are put in a very difficult position. And it's more likely that the environment will shape you than you will be able to shape the environment that you're in. So 30% is kind of the minimum. But mind you, it's a minimum, it's not a maximum. And that's therein lies the danger sometimes with quotas, that once we've set them, we don't look at them as a floor, but as a ceiling. It should be a beginning and not an end. The FIFA reforms include, for instance, a basic quota of 6 women on a council of 37, which translate to a quota of 16.2%. As I said, it's maybe not so much, but compared to what was, it's a very meaningful step into the right direction. Built upon, and it can be a start for long-term sustainable success. In fact, women have the right to be represented equally at all levels of decision-making. 50-50 everywhere is our view and goal in UN Women. And then one can have discussions about the details. But in principle, don't you agree? I mean, there is 50% women in this world and 50% men. What's the reason why there shouldn't be 50-50 everywhere? So including women is not just fair play. It's also been said here today, it's also smart business. It's common sense. Why? As many industries have increasingly recognized, women widen the perspective to the benefit of everyone. Don't get me wrong, not every woman in leadership is an advocate for women's empowerment. And fortunately, an increasing number of men are becoming allies for gender equality. That being said, a diverse organizational leadership enriches discussions, brings different perspectives to the table, and is more likely to represent the diversity of its membership. We all want to feel represented by the bodies that govern us, whether it's in our countries or in the organization of which we are members. And as it has also been said here today, it's not a zero-sum game. It's actually about making the cake bigger in many cases. A report from last year from McKinsey and Company found that companies with higher gender diversity are more likely to have financial returns above their national industry medians. Likewise, new research based on nearly 22,000 companies globally shows that companies with at least 30% female leaders had net profit margins up to 6 percentage points higher than companies with no women in the top ranks. So the numbers are there, the proof is there for those who may doubt it. In addition to the undisputable impact a more diverse leadership has on an organization, women are also a market force to be reckoned with, both for sporting organizations and sports-focused companies. Catering to women's interests and needs will open new revenue streams and increase the economic output. Tapping into the full potential of women around the world will increase productivity at all levels. This is the case for FIFA, member associations, federations, sport companies, and even countries. If men and women played an identical role in the world's labor markets, as much as $28 trillion, or 26%, could be added to the global annual GDP by 2025. Those numbers are mind-boggling because they're so big, but it tells you something. So taking advantage of women's potential is smart business all around. Change doesn't happen overnight. Commitment to the reforms are a first step, but now policy needs to be turned into action. And adding women to the council will be the easiest of tasks. More challenging, but equally important, will be to create equal opportunities for women and girls from the grassroots levels to leadership around the world. I'm impressed by the high number of girls engaged in football worldwide and the commitment of so many parents to make this possible by watching endless practices, organizing fundraisers, and playing chauffeur back and forth. I did myself last time I was home in my home country, Norway, attend one of my granddaughters' game in pouring rain. It was relentless. But to see that spirit and enthusiasm and all the parents and everyone there, it's like, I have to confess, I was glad I was not the parent, just the visiting grandparent, because I was really impressed. But that joy to witness and that commitment, it's priceless. We have to tap into the potential and commitment of girls and engage them in governance of clubs, member associations, and federations at the grassroots level. We need to fill the pipeline for the higher offices. This is something we see in so many industries and organizations. If you don't have a pipeline, it's very hard to recruit on the top. But you also have, of course, to put in measures to prevent that pipeline from leaking, which is often also a problem. Sports can only benefit from the participation of women and girls who lend it their own vibrancy, skills, and even new takes on how, for instance, to win a game. So more girls in sports will just create a stronger base for the sport and over time diversify the organization. Around the world, we see more and more demand for women athletes. As the large World Cup audiences made clear, I think that was an eye-opener for many. More and more parents want their daughters to play sports and want facilities for them to do so. And of course, women and girls in sports want to share their passion. That's something that strikes me here today among all the speakers, and which kind of, to me, as an outsider, makes this forum a bit different from many other places I speak, is that you're not just here in a professional capacity. There is so much underlying passion for why you started in the first place that kind of seeps through your pores almost, and which is very inspiring to witness. Through sports we can teach, this is something also, why is you and women so preoccupied with women in sports? I think it's because we see it as an incredible, forceful arena for girls and women to develop themselves as persons and to develop leadership skills and self-confidence. And a personal observation I have made is that in this day and age, girls are bombarded with images of how they need to look and behave and be. And the risk is that we start very early to look at ourselves from the outside. And how do I look? And am I, you know, what does the world think of me? And to observe girls and women who are active in sports is also to observe human beings who are completely absorbed by what they are doing and they're not having that outside eye on themselves. That I find incredibly fascinating and inspiring, and I think it's also a great foundation. It helps create that great foundation together with learning to fail and to try again and to lose and to try again, to be competitive in a good sense. I think it's such an arena where women, girls and women, can learn extremely important skills to take their full place in society. And if anyone wants to do research, I'd be very curious, because it's my impression when I read interviews with women CEOs and leaders from different fields, and they talk about their childhood. And so often, almost always, I note that they have either been a Girl Scout or they've been an active athlete, or maybe both. So clearly, what we do in our childhood and the opportunities we get as girls to test ourselves and to develop can carry on all through into our adult lives. So we've heard some great examples here today also about the courage it takes and the will to challenge discriminatory stereotypes. And I was especially taken by what Annie told us and how she every day encounters resistance to what she is determined to do, but how she also has that view that it's not just about her, it's also about girls who should see someone like her doing what she's doing. And that can have an impact on so many girls, that someone is breaking those stereotypes and that we girls can see what can be done and what can happen. Not to say that if I had seen great women footballers when I grew up, I would have started playing football. I can't guarantee that, but maybe, I don't know, maybe. The recent Women's World Cup provided an example of how mixed progress has been, though. The event itself reached tens of millions of viewers, breaking television ratings and records, but behind the excitement, gender inequalities were at work. The women were required to play on artificial turf, which is often regarded as more punishing than physically punishing the natural grass. And the World Cup is assumed to be for men, while women required the qualifying women's to describe the event. I think let's get rid of that. Either it's men's football and women's football, or it's football. It speaks to what Michael Kimmel said. What's the norm? What's the normal? When a white man looks himself in a mirror, he just sees a man. Privilege is never visible to those who have it, he said. And so when the norm is a man, or the norm is football, implicitly it's men's football, but that's the norm. And everything else is something else. That also sends a forceful message. It should be easy to change, in my view, men's football and women's football. Across professional sports, in fact, one of the most obvious and quantifiable manifestations of gender discrimination is that women athletes face a huge pay gap. The total payout for the Women's World Cup was $15 million, compared with $576 million for the last Men's World Cup, 40 times less. And now there can be rational explanations for one business having become bigger than the other, with more money circulating, but it's still interesting then to see what happened after Billie Jean King managed to institute equal pay in tennis, and in professional tennis. And it's thanks to her heroic efforts that since 2007, there has been awarded equal prize money at all four Grand Slam tournaments. And this should be the model to which all sports aspire, even if it may take time to get there. Today, UN Women is at work in 90 countries around the world to drive greater progress in achieving women's empowerment and gender equality. We've made a commitment to a promise, the promise of equal rights and opportunities for women and men, girls and boys. And we're determined to deliver on it, from advancing women's political participation, to expanding economic opportunities for women, to mobilizing to end violence against women and girls, to increasing women's participation in peace building, and to making sure that budgets and plans work for women. At UN Women, we've given gender inequality an expiration date of 2030. This might seem ambitious, and it is, but it's also within our reach. As our executive director, Pumzil, likes to say, this is not mission impossible, this is a mission for our time. We look to the world of sports knowing that every organization and team, coach and player, can step up action and join the push to make gender equality happen by 2030. Our goal is simply 50-50 by 2030. It's big and ambitious, but we think it can be done. Governments, the United Nations system, civil society, the sports movement, and other actors have all come together around the recognition of how much sport can contribute to the social, economic, and political empowerment of women and girls. And there could be no more explicit endorsement of this notion than that in the new Agenda 2030 for Sustainable Development, which was adopted at the United Nations in September, last September, by all countries of the world. The agenda is a landmark roadmap for global progress over the next 15 years. And it states in paragraph 37 that sport will be an important enabler for development and for women's empowerment. It also makes achieving gender equality and empowering all women and girls one of the 17 sustainable development goals, and commits to gender equality across many other dimensions, such as in education, health, and poverty reduction. The goals come with a series of targets on which every country must regularly report. As such, they serve as important touchstones to galvanize progress, measure change, and ensure the world moves fast enough to reach the goal. Similarly, for FIFA's newly adopted reforms, to bring on board more women, for this to be truly successful, there has to be accountability for results. The minimum of 6 women on the council should not become the maximum. FIFA needs to put in place targets, measurements, reporting, and accountability at all levels to ensure the full participation and representation of girls and women. FIFA will benefit from taking a look at your whole structure and determine where the follow-up and monitoring needs to happen. New policies without targets, monitoring, and accountability are almost certainly bound to fail, history shows. Similarly, and it could be done, I mean, in addition to governments, there are companies now that they stand by their numbers on an annual or biannual basis. They show the world what they have achieved on the targets they have set for themselves. This could also be a challenge to FIFA, also in line with its new commitment to more transparency. Show the world the progress you are making in including more women. Where it's happening, how many. Similarly, follow the money, the saying goes. The real reflection of whether an organization means business when committing to gender equality is whether it puts its money where its mouth is. Now is the time to act on this recognition and bring the benefits of sports to all women and girls. Much depends on your leadership in the world of sports and your dedication to actions such as ending gaps in decision-making and access to sports facilities. We all must contest, as individuals and organizations, the stereotypes that hold us all back and champion new, progressive, equal norms. As the global champion for gender equality and women's empowerment for all women everywhere, a central aspect of our strategy at UN Women is to amplify women's voices and expand women's roles as leaders and advocates for change, including through sports. And so for us to walk the talk, we have started partnering with sports organizations, and we hope to expand this and do more of it. As I said earlier, we see this as such an important arena for girls' development and for more gender equality down the line. For example, we're proud to partner with the International Olympic Committee, and we have a joint legacy program that kicked off recently in Brazil. It empowers thousands of young women and girls in the state of Rio de Janeiro through sport. It creates safe spaces for girls to break social barriers, equips them with basic economic skills, increased knowledge of their bodies, and the confidence to access services in the event of violence. We also have a partnership with Georgia Rugby Union, where messages on ending violence against women have been the focus of international rugby matches held in Georgia, pre and post match press conferences, public service announcement, and TV commercial during aired during the games. And the male rugby players have been trained in delivering messages on ending violence against women and to engage other men and boys to address this problem. And last example is we have a partnership with the Valencia Football Club, which features UN women and gender equality messages on its jerseys in the stadium during UEFA and Champions League games, and also has clinics for girls and boys, and contributes funding to UN's women's works. Through our presence internationally and within individual countries, we will continue carrying the torch in many other sports arenas, and we look forward to exploring opportunities for collaboration with FIFA. Together, we can achieve a future where all playing fields are truly level for all women and girls. The Sustainable Development Goals at the broader level are there to help us guide and track progress. I appeal to you who are involved in football governance at any level to embrace this opportunity of rewritten rules to ensure a level playing field for women and girls. UN Women stands ready to support FIFA in the implementation of these reforms. FIFA has a chance now to become a beacon to the world in showing what it takes to create equal opportunities for women and men through sport. This is a great moment for the beautiful game, and the moment is now. Thank you, and happy International Women's Day.
Well, thank you so much, Kristin, and UN Women for, you know, being a continued leading light and a voice for gender equality and certainly the development of women in sport and women across the board as well. I think you also just put paid to a lot of the discussions that we've been having throughout the conference today. And most importantly, there was that call to action. As you said, the time to act is now. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about the action after this conference, what happens. Let's talk about reforms as well. And someone who continues to be very vociferous when it comes to this is, amongst many of her titles, the champion of FIFA's task force on women's football. She's a co-opted FIFA executive committee member. Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Moya Dodd.
Well, thank you very much for your introduction and for your attendance, and especially those who are watching online, probably in the middle of the night. It's one of my favourite activities too in Australia, is to follow things at strange hours of the day. But it's huge to be amongst so many sheroes and heroes today, and I'm sure you feel the same thing, just being in a room with some of the people who've spoken, some of the people who've been here and part of the movement for reform. It's a privilege in itself, but it's also very inspiring for what comes next. Because we've kicked a couple of goals lately. It's been a good couple of weeks for football. We've had the reforms passed through Congress. We've had the first edition of the Women's Leadership Program graduate in Amsterdam a few days ago. Some of them are here. Felicity was part of that program, which is fantastic. And today we're celebrating International Women's Day here at FIFA House with a room full of people, with the world's media watching, and with many people around the world following it online. So I was very glad that there's such a thing as a quota. And one day I might write a book called My Life as a Quota, because when the game opened up 6 or 9 months ago, there were three of us on the FIFA Executive Committee, and we looked at each other and said, of course it's time for reform, but why is nobody talking about gender equality? The fact that we were there, that we had the opportunity to be heard, it's called the power of the pulpit. My friend Mary Harvey, who was very much part of the reform movement, calls it the power of the pulpit. Having a position means that I can stand here and talk and some people will listen. And that gave us the opportunity to step into the game when things opened up, when the football world was reeling from the shocks that occurred in May and in September. The game opened up, and it's a little bit like being a player. You know, if you look up and you see the fullbacks are out of position, the two centre-backs are on the carpet, the midfield's been sent off, and you think, you know, even the goalkeeper's off their line. We can make some progress here. We can move the ball up the park. And when the game opens up, your first instinct is to get the ball and accelerate into the space, to find a teammate who's running into that space. And that's really what the reform movement on gender equality, that's how it began. A few of us looked at each other and said, well, you know, if we can make a difference here, we could make 10 years of progress in 6 months, so let's give it a go. And that's really how it started. And there was a groundswell. We did something, and then something else happened, and something else happened. The phone started ringing around the world. A lot of you would have got phone calls or made phone calls. You got active on social media. We put a hashtag out there, hashtag women in FIFA. 47 million timeline feeds on Twitter. That hashtag has been around the world. More than 10 million have engaged with the hashtag. And so when Sarai Barrowman was in the room at the Reform Committee, she could take in a brief that said, more than 10 million people are interested in this. It's not just one or two women, it's not just the three in the executive committee, it's not just the one in the reform committee, but there are millions of women around the world. There are 30 million who play. There are millions more who don't yet play because they haven't been given the chance. There are fans who watch and they want to be part of this game. One way you can improve the game is to let the women in the door. And the world was ready to hear that message. The New York Times took an article about it. The New York Times took an article about women's equality in football. That's something that I didn't think would happen, but impossible things keep happening all the time in this game. And as Nelson Mandela said, it always seems impossible until it's done. Well, some of those things are done, and some of them are not yet done. But you and your voices change the conversation about the reforms. Gender equality became a key feature of the reforms, so much so that when they were to be announced, when they were being talked about in the lead up to Congress, when they were being talked about after they'd passed, in the moments after they'd passed, Delia Fisher, who's here, working for communications in FIFA, who did she hand the microphone to after the reforms passed during Congress? Well, the people who went outside and walked past that barrage of cameras were Sonia, Lydia, Sarai, and I. We got to be the face of FIFA reform. That, I thought that was impossible, but it just happened. Gender equality became an election issue. Became an election issue in a FIFA election. And candidates were asked, there are at least three surveys that I know of, where the candidates were asked, so what would you do on gender equality? And they answered. And they gave some good answers, actually, which I thought I might share with you, because they were so good. One candidate answered to a survey from Women in Football, the UK-based group, and there's a few members here, Joyce, Ebru, and others. One candidate answered, if I'm elected the next FIFA president, women's football will be a priority and this will be reflected in how FIFA distributes its development funding. We will increase FIFA dedicated staff to oversee and appropriately monitor the development programs delivered specifically for women's football projects. Furthermore, we'll strengthen the cooperation with the federation, the confederations, to create synergies for greater support. Lastly, specific initiatives will be put in place to support the member associations to develop their club and league structures, to further drive that growth and improve the grassroots and elite player pathway systems. Then the questions got better. Do you believe that FIFA should itself be a leader and a model of gender equality? If so, how will you as FIFA president ensure that this occurs? Specifically, will you commit to identify and eliminate any gender pay gap in FIFA? Yes. Commit to an independent third-party audit of gender equality in FIFA? If yes, will you publish the results? Yes. I'm glad to say that that candidate is sitting right here and he'll be on the pulpit next, up the front next. But gender equality became an election issue where candidates were vying, others promised to actively pursue a woman CEO or to have a 30% gender balance target in committees. This was a thing during the FIFA election process. But it's not over, of course, that's just a start. What was in the reform package were the reforms that the Reform Committee and the Executive Committee were confident could reach a 75% approval threshold on the floor of Congress. So working backwards from there, what was in the package was the biggest takeable step that consensus would would give us a 75% majority that we needed to take them through Congress. What happens next, I would think, will go further than that. It's just really a first step. And Rebecca Smith, who also works for FIFA in the competitions group, was talking to me a couple of days ago, and she said, how does it feel? You know, there's been such big steps forward. And I looked at her and I said, well, you know, it's all about what comes next. And she said, I know, it's like you're 2-0 up at half time. And we all know that the 2-0 lead is the most dangerous one in football. It's the one that's easy to lose and where you need to focus the hardest to keep yourself ahead. So this is a little bit like a half-time of the reforms, but it's all about what happens next. From here, it's all about what happens next. It's implementation time, not just for us at FIFA, but for the whole pyramid of football. And I want to talk to you about your role in that. Because when you look at all of the stories and the histories that brought us all here today, embedded in every one of them, I'm sure, is a number of things that you share in common. And I'm willing to bet that if you're a woman in football, you're determined, you don't take no for an answer, you're passionate about the game and being part of it, I'm getting nods already, you didn't get there because you played golf with the CEO, I'm willing to bet, and you're a bit of a badass, to use a presidential term from the US. So all of your journeys that brought you here uniquely qualify you to be the person who takes the ball forward up the field next, because that ball's coming to you now. It's coming to you. You have a voice. You have a platform. You have a circle of influence. You can talk about the change that you want. You can tug on a sleeve. You can find another voice to join yours. And you might find it's a chorus. And your voice can change the room. It can change the conversation. And to borrow from a more famous speech than this one, if you can change a room, you can change a club. And if you can change a club, you can change a federation. And if you can change a federation, you can change FIFA. And if you can change FIFA, you can change the world. And I think we're all up for that. Thank you. So we're now going to go to a part of the world that you may not have been to. I think we're going to Malawi to see how football can change the world there, and then we'll return for a short further conversation about reform. Thank you.
In our culture, most of the girls become very shy. They don't want to show that they can do what men can do.
So it was a very difficult situation to play the game of football. But little by little, now we are now catching up. We are trying to apply that everything must be done by women themselves. Even the coaching field, we need to have women coaches.
I think it's good to have good women coaches, just because we are able to know the problems of the girls rather than men. We were using football as a tool to carry the messages of health. So as they go, they know football and health issues.
Because so many girls, maybe they do shy when they have men coaches. So we need to have more women coaches. Then we can also have more women players.
And there is a bright future because I can see more young talented players who have joined this national team than before. So there is a potential in that.
Women's football has been growing in Malawi. We have clubs. We've gone past teaching them how to control and shoot the ball. They're able now to play football at par with men. Who knows? Maybe the women can help us go to the World Cup quicker than the men.
The introduction of the national team which is currently in training, this is the first national team that Malawi has assembled. We are now in the right direction. We are now moving forward because the door has been opened for many girls, for many women to start playing football. The national team is now born. Keep it and maintain it and implement the program for its progress and develop it at a higher level.
I love that. Malawi is literally just around the corner from where I am in South Africa. But the reality is that case study is becoming more and more the reality for a lot of previously disadvantaged member associations. And it really is the reason why we're all here, just to spearhead that and to fast track the development of the women's game all across the globe. So I think all the discussions that we've had so far have proven to be the perfect backdrop to bring us to this particular point where we are stressing what happens next after this conference. Let's talk about 2016 FIFA reforms on women's football and women in football. Our final panel discussion is about to get underway. And joining us, our panelists, because he's here, we're going to invite the FIFA president, Gianni Infantino, to please be a part of this panel. But President, only for a little bit. We'll allow you to be part of this discussion right there. And then we're going to dismiss you. There we go. We're going to let you go during the discussion, Moya. I'll ask you to come back and join this panel as well. Also coming up is the president of the U.S. Soccer Federation, and that is Mr. Sunil Gulati. The only female in the FIFA 2016 Reform Committee. Please come up, Sarai Barman. Arbitrator at the Court of Arbitration for Sports, Sylvia Schenk. Please come up as well. And CNN Sports anchor correspondent, my colleague, Amanda Davies. Yeah. And after that great selfie, I'll start off with you, President Infantino. I mean, we talk about one of the wins for FIFA, 26th of February 2016, besides, of course, your election, certainly has to have been the reforms, the set of reforms that were passed by that extraordinary Congress. Tell us a little bit more about that and the importance of seeing those reforms through.
Well, it was crucial. It was crucial for FIFA to have these reforms passed. We invested a lot of time and a lot of efforts. Sarah, I can testify that in getting these reforms. It's a process. It was a process as well. I mean, when we started with the reform committee, we were far, far away from what the end result was, and we would never have expected, I would never have expected personally, to get there so fast and to reach such groundbreaking reforms. Now, of course, we have to say it as well, I said it briefly this morning, the reforms and the reason for these reforms had nothing to do with gender equality, with women in football and so on. But I'm very happy that it became also one of the topics, thanks to the insistence of Sarah and some others here in this room as well. Everywhere, but because it's good, because we have to grasp the opportunity when the opportunity is there. I said it for myself, I was, until some 5-6 months ago, I was not thinking or dreaming of being a candidate for the presidency. Now I'm the FIFA president, and it's good that Moya reminded me of what I said. I said many things during the campaign, but I said many things that I believe in as well. And you have to do the things when they are ready. But you have to make change happen. Mm-hmm. You have to act, you have to convince. You don't have to impose. I don't believe in dictates. I believe in work, in convincing people, in being aware that it's a tough job, everything. And I'm there for this. I'm happy that the reforms passed, and I'm happy that this is the first conference which speaks about the reforms, because this as well is a signal and a symbol of what we want to achieve in the future.
Mm. Sarai, I know you want to add to that. I mean, this was a definite step in the right direction, because we're always talking about this call to action, you know, implementing, you know, so much that we've been discussing over the years.
Yeah, definitely. I think, as somebody said it earlier today, that, you know, the times where great change have come about and where women are called in has always been when there is a crisis or there is an issue. And like Moya said in her speech earlier, the issues that happened in FIFA that everyone is so aware about was a massive opportunity for us to really take that ball and, like she said, run with it. And yeah, I mean, it's historical, not only in terms of gender equality and increased women's representation within football and FIFA, but for FIFA as a governing body, you know, having the reforms passed, having our new president in place now, we are perfectly placed to move forward in a really positive, really energetic, hopefully very innovative way. Yeah.
Mm, agreed. Amanda, I mean, today must have been really exciting for you, as it was for me as well, as a member of the media. I mean, hearing about, and we were aware of it, the challenges.
Just the fact that I'm inside as opposed to the end of the driveway in the cold.
Yeah, that, yeah. And just hearing about the challenges, we're aware of it, you know, and the way forward. It was an exciting time when you heard about the reforms, but now we are, of course, poised to see how it is that they're going to be implemented, and you're looking forward to that happening.
Yeah, I think there's no doubt that football has changed. Mm. I think everybody in this room pretty much has a story about their journey in football and the no's that they've received along the way. Mm. I was very fortunate. I had a father who loved football, was brought up by women, as opposed to he didn't have a father figure in his life. So for him, there was never any question that because I'm a woman, I couldn't watch football. But then I realised very quickly at school, I wanted to set up a women's football team. No, that wasn't allowed to happen. I was lucky enough as a young child to go to football, to go to boardrooms. And age 9, I wasn't allowed to stay with my dad in the boardroom. I had to go into the women's room. Hmm. And literally a table like that in the corner with a cup of tea and a sandwich. And women couldn't talk about football, of course. And then when Karen Brady became managing director of Birmingham City, age 23, that was like, hang on a minute, but she's a woman and she's meant to come in the boardroom, and people were sent into blind panic. And I still get, as a journalist of 17, 18 years, but you don't really like football, do you? Mm. And I do, funnily enough, I do. But this isn't just a football problem, is it? It's a problem of women in society. Hollywood are fighting against it. Journalism is fighting against it. And there's no doubt that in football in recent years, things have changed. We've got professional leagues. We have events like this. And a lot more is being made of the issue. Sepp Blatter was the person who, Donna said the future of football is female. Mm-hmm. He didn't necessarily then, with his words, follow that up in necessarily the right way, but there has been change. And at this time where FIFA needs a few friends, it needs a few more fans, this actually, as Sarah and I were saying earlier, this is a relatively easy win for FIFA. By not huge changes, FIFA could lead the way in society, across industry, and actually make a real change if these reforms, which look okay on paper, definitely could go further, but if these reforms are actually implemented, then FIFA could start leading the way.
Mm, agreed. Moya, tell us a little bit more about this. I mean, there was a set of reforms that was put out there, but there's plenty more as well to be investigated and discussed further to these.
Yeah, I mean, I think the two main things that were asked for in the reforms was greater participation in decision-making. So we were asking for a 30% gender balance in all decision-making bodies. That would mean that all the decisions that come from the top down would have the benefit of gender inclusion. And we were asking for a fair resourcing obligation, a little Title IX-ish for the many people in the room who are very connected with Title IX, Donna being one of the original fighters for all of that. And many people, Abby and others, as beneficiaries, children of Title IX, a fair resourcing thing. So you just couldn't ever get the situation where women's football was completely unresourced by, in the country by the governing body that was meant to be running it. And to avoid that, we wanted there to be some regulatory mechanism that says you've got to fairly resource the women's game in proportion, in fair proportion, with our participation and our potential. Now, those words weren't adopted. What was adopted was something that, that people felt, with a consensus view, could garner the necessary 75% majority to get it through Congress. So nobody wanted to risk that package. I mean, we all knew how important it was, not just on gender equality, but on everything, for the future of this organisation, that that package would pass. So it wasn't, you know, loaded up with all kinds of stretch targets or ambitious things. What was in there were the essentials for reform. That said, once they've been passed, leadership is leadership. Leadership is about moving ahead of where the bottom 30% or 25% will let you go. It's about leading. Leadership is about leading. It's about being ahead of the game. And one would think that if you're going to lead, then you're ahead of that level that you know that you're confident 75% will pass. You're not constrained by that, and you're able to look forward and think what is the best for the future of our sport and the future of our organisation. So I think there's more to follow. I mean, I know this will be a matter of dialogue among the President, the Council members and the Confederations and members. But that dialogue needs to take place because what we have is a great step forward. It's the biggest takeable step that we could have taken on February the 26th, but it's certainly not the last word in reform.
Mm. Sylvia, in your opinion, gender equality, is this an integral part of FIFA reform, of the FIFA reform process, or is it seen as an add-on?
Well, for a reform process, you always need three parts. That's one is persons, one part is structure, and one part is cultural change. And with regard to persons, we have a new president, we will have a new general secretary, we will have at least six women in the future FIFA council, so there is some change, or will be some change. We have the new statutes, yes, it's right, they have to be implemented, but what will take even more time is the cultural change. But if you have more diversity, not just in the council, but in other bodies as well, and if you let all the wonderful women working already for FIFA as staff members, let really do what they want to do, then I'm quite sure that there will be the cultural change as well. And only if these three points really work together, then FIFA will be perceived as a really new organization. And then FIFA can lead the way for other sports as well. And I'm quite happy that nowadays I can even tell other federations, well, look what FIFA is doing with regard to women. And for quite a long time, FIFA was a bad example, and now it's already starting to be a good example for this part of the reform.
Is the concern here maybe that this is a time of crisis for FIFA? Yes, in some ways a line has been drawn with a new president coming in, the reforms have been passed, but if you look at the whole of FIFA's problems at this moment in time, the public perception of FIFA's problems, is the concern now that actually the women's issue will drop down the ranking? Yes, the numbers have been written on the pieces of paper, but actually in terms of everything UGIANI have to do moving forward, where does this rank?
Top
this
priority.
Is why I'm this end and you're this end.
Time flies, Gianni.
Yeah.
Well, I don't think it's a question of ranking. It's a question of doing things. It's a question of priorities. I mean, I know very well, and there are a few ex-co-members here, still ex-co-members, soon council members. They will have, of course, to support me, and I said it, and that because I believe in it. I mean, and even if my daughters, they play handball and not football, but football and women's football is that's how it is. It is a priority. It is a priority. It is, of course, today, and I have to be honest about this, it is not the top priority because FIFA has some very, 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 very big problems and issues to sort out, which we have to sort out because if we don't sort out these issues, then we don't speak about football, about women's football anymore, but we don't speak about football anymore. I mean, to court, as such, we have to save FIFA, We have to save world football and women's football, and women in football is part of this process, and it's certainly one of the priorities. But I wouldn't make a ranking out of it.
But I'm sure also that the president being here, you know, and adding his voice to this particular conference also is a clear indication that it is a priority. Just a quick one before Moya. Sunil, I mean, at this point in time, we're always talking about this call to action. Is there that tangible progress now that we're feeling? You were part of the football symposium at the Women's World Cup, looking at 2015 being such an integral year for women's football. Are we following through with the calls to action then? Are you seeing that happening?
Well, it's early, right? I agree with what Gianni said.
Thank you.
As a vice president, I have to agree with him. It's statutory. So, look, we're going to see. He's absolutely right. We're still in a crisis mode. But let's be very clear. These were huge steps that got taken. And in a very real sense, they had no business being in the reform effort. Right? That's not what it was about. So it's phenomenal that Moya and others managed to get this in. This was, she said it perfectly. This was 10 steps ahead because they had access. They were in the boardroom. But if you had asked any of us that were in the ExCo or in the council, this is going to be part of it 8 months ago, this wasn't what the reform effort was about. So that this was part of it is a huge step forward. And you don't take steps back. Right? It may not be the quick steps forward that you want right away, but to get six people on, did it go far enough? The answer is no, right? And we both agree, Johnny and I have talked a lot about this. This is what we could get for now in this area or in so many other areas that you would like to see a few more things happen, no doubt, Sylvia, in some of the other areas of reform, as would I, as would others. But this was a huge step forward, but it's gonna take now a lot of effort by a lot of people, whether it's in this room, and a lot of people who run member associations who still vote, and as we've already talked about, 207 of them are men. But you know, for all the things that we've talked about the last 24 hours, and I've learned a lot of things. I could tick off all the things I've learned. I couldn't possibly speak at a conference like this without acknowledging. I usually see Billie Jean King once a year at a foundation event that she hosts, so it's good to have her here. And we've been fortunate in the U.S. We've had a history of people. Billie Jean obviously started so much of it. Donna DeVerona's been a hero. We've had players who have been leaders in this area. Abby's now taken the mantle. Julie Foudy for many years. Mary Harvey, who was a gold medalist for us and changed the way our board works and the way our organization works. So we've been lucky, and I think, that there's a lot of countries in the world that aren't going to have the same resources or the same areas. But this is an opportunity now that we can't miss. It's not going to be tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock. That's, I think, the point. But I don't think we're going back, Amanda, at all. I think this is going forward. One of the things that I asked my board when we were going to come to Zurich to cast a vote, if you have any thoughts, and the multiple people on my board raised two issues, governance, which was obvious, and we want to know where the candidates stand on gender issues. And we didn't need to spend any time with him because I knew where he stood on it. We had talked about it enough in the past.
Moya?
Okay, so here's the thing, right?
Yes.
This is my pitch to you. We don't need to think about women as a problem that need to be solved or addressed and ranked in order of all the other problems that you're facing. We know you have a lot of problems. We know that FIFA has a lot of problems. We're part of the solution. So we're here, and here's the opportunity for you. We're part of the solution commercially because we have one big, big revenue stream. We have one big asset called the Men's World Cup. We need more than one. So there's one. There's a couple of opportunities sitting right there, the Women's World Cup, maybe a Club World Cup, to start diversifying our revenue streams. And any business person will tell you that's a good idea. Secondly, we have a brand problem. We have a really bad brand problem. And women are part of the solution to fix it. Because of all the horrible things you hear about FIFA, none of them are about women's football. I haven't heard a bad thing about the Women's World Cup. I haven't heard a bad thing about the women in football. Or nobody's saying, oh, you know, if only there were less women in FIFA, it would be a better game, right? Nobody said that. Said no one ever. So there's part of your branding answer. And thirdly, you have, not just in this room, but if you can imagine a whole lot of people behind screens and iPads right now who are watching this, that's your tailwind. There's a whole lot of people out there who, if you ask them, would do anything to help women advance in football. And there's an army of foot soldiers out there who will be your advocates, your assistants, and your champions to make the game better. So that's my pitch to you.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Let's do it. We're going to let the president go very, very shortly. Sylvia, quick one. Do you think that women in leadership is important to improve transparency and accountability? I mean, Amanda just talking about the tumultuous time that FIFA has just come from and is, you know, really just trying to ride the wave and get past. What is your view on this?
Well, the problem with FIFA was in the old boys' network that has grown over decades. And so women are coming into it quite newly now, and they are not they have not been part of the old FIFA, so that will help with the reputation on the one hand. And then, again, if you have a diverse body, it's much more difficult to have networks growing like you had in the past. And I think that's a very important issue. And like you said, it's a big chance now for FIFA to work with women and to have women in very different places. It's not just the council. It has to be more in the bodies, on the continental level, on the national level. But with that, we will see a new FIFA.
Mm. Sarai, the only female on the reform committee, how do we turn policy into action?
I think it needs to be a two-pronged approach. It has to happen from the top down. Mm. We're talking about from FIFA level through the new council, down through the confederations, but it also needs to come from the bottom up, and this is where the grassroots comes into it. This is where, you know, the women who are out there every day, and men, at the member associations, on the ground level, in the activities, part of the development, running the competitions, it has to come from that level too. And it's important that there is some education and communication that goes down to that level to let them know what has happened. Mm. I mean, I was really surprised in the Women's Leadership Conference in Amsterdam a few days ago that there were some women in the room who weren't aware about the reforms that had passed and what had been done at that level. So the communication all the way down through the chain to the bottom, it's got to happen.
All right, well, we're going to let the president go very politely so we can continue this conversation, and then we'll invite you for your closing comments, yeah?
I will be back.
Please do so. A round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.
I've heard that
thank
before.
You.
Yeah, it's all good, huh? No, but let me just say one more thing, and I will speak then. Mm. Of course, I will come back for the conclusion. What Moya says, I firmly believe in that. I firmly believe that women are part of the solution, and that's why I'm also happy that this conference takes place here today, because it shows where we want to go. It shows that we can speak about things, which is already, I think, quite a big progress. Mm-hmm. It shows that we can speak about this in a very open way, and it shows that we can move things and we can make things happen in reality, because this goes also to the top-down approach, but also to the bottom-up approach, to the education, to the discussion, to the bringing to everyone this message and try to convince everyone to make the things happen. So with this, I mean, I let you discuss, and I'm coming back
for the closing comments. Thank you.
Closing.
Yeah, okay. Thank you so much. Amanda, you wanted to continue with the conversation, add on, yeah?
I was going to say, with what Sarai says, I think it's absolutely right. You need the top down, you need the bottom up. Mm. But what has struck me here today, I'm not somebody who has spent my life covering women's football at all. I cover football. Is that one size doesn't necessarily fit all here. There is the leadership issue, which and women in executive roles, which is one issue. There is then the playing issue, and there are a lot of differences across the world and up to down. There are social differences. There are developmental differences. Women in certain parts of the world aren't even allowed to play the game, let alone enter an office in an executive level. And that is the problem, where we need it to be accountable, these reforms. We need targets that are able to be hit. But are those targets for the US different for targets in other parts of the world? And I don't have the answer to that, but it doesn't necessarily take one solution.
I think about some of these issues,
as an economist, and that's what I do, is the day job. And this is something along these lines that I said last year in Vancouver. The return on women's football, women's sports, for 175 out of our 209 members so far exceeds what it does on men's football. So just imagine the following situation. Pick a number, whether it's $10,000 or $100,000 or $1 million. That level of investment wouldn't make a bit of difference in any top national team program on the men's side. By the way, in the U.S., we have a U.S. women's national team and a U.S. men's national team. We don't have a U.S. national team. So just coming back to that for a second. But for a couple hundred thousand dollars, you could qualify a team for the Women's World Cup if you put some resources and targeted. On the men's side, right now, it wouldn't matter. So think of this as common sense rate of return, including for the executives, right? You want to see gold medals or silver medals or team qualify? Costa Rica, spend some money, put some resources about it. Nowhere near what we do or what England might or Germany might. And other teams have done the same. A few hundred thousand dollars or $1 million for their men's program wouldn't do very much. But on the women's side, because it was you were starting from scratch, so pure economics, if there's fertile ground here and you put some money against this, the rate of return is going to be enormous.
But as we discussed last night, parts of the world.
That was off the record, by the way. These journalists, you can't trust them.
There are parts of the world where it's not pure economics. There are social, there are religious, ethical, moral issues that are also coming into play.
But those exist in a lot of places. It's going to be harder there, for sure. Mm-hmm. I agree with that.
Well, I think it's quite important to link the issue of development of women's football to other issues. And we just talked about priorities. So one priority for FIFA is to deal with the human rights issues and different parts, Qatar and so on. I don't have to mention everything. And of course, the participation of girls and women in sport and whether they can be spectators for a men's game, for example, in Iran or other countries, that's a question of human rights too. And so with John Ruckey now just assessing FIFA's business with regard to human rights, women and girls are a part of that and must be a part of it.
Mm. Just a reminder that we're also inviting any questions, any comments from any of you. We'll come right down here, first of all, to Donna.
While the mic's coming, I just want to, in response to Amanda's question, I just want to say, please keep the mic coming.
Don't slow down for her.
I just want to say that the fact that it's difficult in some parts of the world is not a reason a reason to stop doing it. The fact that some leagues are non-existent or women's football is non-existent in some countries is not a reason not to create an elite club World Cup at the top end of the game, because it's all about progress rather than perfection. Mm. And progress means different things in different parts of the world. In South Africa, because FIFA said you should have a woman on the board a couple of years ago in the 10 principles that were passed at the Brazil Congress, South Africa went and asked for women to be on all their boards in all their regions. So there's now hundreds of women who are preparing for leadership in South Africa. You know, that happened just because FIFA said it.
I just have two comments. One is I held my breath when the comment was made that with this crisis, the women's agenda wouldn't have been considered unless you had three women on the board. And that shows you how a quota is important and how effective just three women against an army of men have been. Secondly, when you talk about the differences in cultures, which there are, one example is the International Olympic Committee basically said any country that wants to bid on the Olympics has to have women participate. And in London, every single country had a woman participate. So it has to come from the top, the leadership. I mean, it wasn't deep. Some of it was, they were able to qualify because of the rule in some federations that you don't have to meet a time standard, you can participate. But it still brought the whole community forward. And again, it takes time, but I just want to congratulate the women on the board that stood up and really did this, and the men that stood with them. Sunil, you've done that in the U.S., and I know the U.S. is... It's different because we've had 40-some years of the teeth of a federal law and then enlightened leaders in football that, again, decided to take the tournament in 1999 to the biggest arenas. Mm. And that nobody believed in that. The press thought it was going to be a joke. But there was buy-in because of a lot of hard work and because the players went out and promoted it. But I'm just saying that, you know, if you set the standard and you have the real leadership, speak to it. with support from the media and everyone else, you can get there. Thank you.
And Sarai, I mean, we're looking at the fact that the beautiful game is the number one sport in the world, celebrated globally. So why can't FIFA set the standard, lead the way in terms of course, you know, leading the way for women development, for raising the standard of the game, and other sport organizations can follow after?
We can.
Yeah.
Yeah, we absolutely can. And now we are so perfectly placed to do that. And, you know, there are so many great minds in this room. There has been so many great discussions, but there are so many people that aren't here today that can also make a big change. And it was Billie Jean that said this morning, everyone is an influencer. And I love that. I love that. And I truly, truly believe that. You know, I mean, if 5 years ago, if you would have asked me, I'd be sitting on a panel here in front of all these people on a live stream talking about the reforms of FIFA. Mm-hmm. I would have told you, no way, that's ridiculous. You know, and I started from a member association as a finance officer. I worked my way up through that. And, you know, it's just through passion and drive and, you know, a real fire inside me that I was able to make change and influence. And there are so many people out there that can do it, men and women. And, you know, we've got this fantastic governing body, FIFA, which has a lot of resources. Mm-hmm. And it's at a time of change, and we must use this. We have to ride this wave. We've got to keep the, you know, keep the gas on and really take this opportunity and run with it.
Keep the momentum going. We've got another, okay, right in front, yeah.
Joyce Cook, I asked a question this morning. First of all, sorry, I'm such a fan of yours. We did the women's leadership together, and you're just the best woman to have been in the position you were in, and I knew personally how safe hands we were in at that point. And a special well done to Moya, because I think we all recognise how your determination made sure that this all got through, and I was very pleased to see disability included. But my question's this. I agree that at the moment we need to have more talent coming from the grassroots of the game, but surely isn't this the moment to extend that talent pool to all of us that passionately care and work for this game as NGOs, as fans, and all of those other key stakeholders? Isn't it in time for those people to be invited to the party too? There's a huge talent pool out there. And perhaps we also need to turn attention to other areas, perhaps commercial areas, where we know really smart women already exist. I'm not saying we aren't smart in this room, but experienced women that can come to the table. But for that to happen, for that independent voice to come and have fresh ideas, fresh approaches, perhaps a less fear of speaking up because of not being so ensconced within the game, perhaps it's time for that now. And how does the panel feel about that?
Well, it's on the face. If the reforms, this is maybe not something I would have said quite this way 10 days ago while we were trying to get the reforms passed, if the reforms stop at the FIFA level and don't get to member associations and don't get to committees at member associations, Sylvia's touched on this, then this part of it is a failure. Eventually, it's got to do that. Adding three women and increasing the size of the council to 37 to make it 16%. Isn't a solution. It's the start of a process. It's some access, it's some opportunity. At U.S. Soccer, and we're in a different situation than many other countries, I get that, we don't even meet these targets right now. So for everything we do, we don't have 30% on our board. That's disappointing to me. We also don't have any African Americans on our board. We have one Hispanic on our board. So there's still a lot of work to be done in the U.S. Mm. We've invested a lot of resources in our women's program, but I wouldn't say we've got equal access and opportunity for women yet. And we're quite a way along there. Some of the Scandinavian countries are even further ahead. But if it stops at what happened last week and doesn't get to the confederations and doesn't get to federations and member associations and to clubs right throughout, then it's not a success. And it wouldn't be a success. It's going to have to get to those places and then be much more inclusive at all the way down to the grassroots level, whether it's coaching, refereeing, playing, we've talked about separately, but certainly in the decision making, it has to do that.
And my question really was those of us that work in and around the game for the good of the game. And at the moment, there isn't a track in for those stakeholders.
Can I?
Yeah, yeah, go ahead, Sarah.
I just want to give a little shout out for Joyce who answered this question. And I know where this question is coming from.
So Joyce is the managing director of an organisation called CAFE, and their main objective is getting access for disabled people into football. And this all started from her being in a position as a disabled person, not being able to get into a stadium and watch a football match because there was no access. And I think, yes, this is the moment where we need to bring organisations like yours. There's NGOs, we've got UN Women, UNICEF, there are so many other organisations out there that have expertise, they have knowledge, they have research, they have funds, they've already fought this fight. And, you know, if we don't bring these people on board to help us, you know...
And now there's a way to do that, by the way, whether it's a committee level or MA level, through independent directors, independent, required independent people. So that's a natural way to get people involved.
And I mean...
Yes. Absolutely will happen, sure.
A number of the committees have a minimum number of independent members that have to be on that committee. All of the governance committee, more than half the development committee, the finance committee. I mean, this means taking the sort of sealed capsule of football governance and breaking it open and getting some fresh air through there. Mm-hmm.
And Amanda, I was going to say, I mean, the fight for gender equality isn't one that's unique to just FIFA. So there's other best practices that FIFA can learn from. Do you believe that there are other best practices that FIFA can learn from if you look at other sports organisations, if you look at, other initiatives, other organisations?
I think, as I said, FIFA isn't unique and arguably is doing better than some other sports in terms of women's football versus men's football, and you look at other sports. Tennis is doing better than some. You had that link up last week between the PGA and the LPGA. But I think the key with all of this is the word that Donna used again: momentum. And we had the Women's Olympics, as it was billed, 2012, which yes heralded a fantastic 3 weeks for women's sport. But then you have to put your hands up and say that wave definitely has dipped in a big way, and yes, it's gearing up again, heading into the next Olympics. But it's about, as we were talking about earlier, keeping those flagship key moments going throughout the year and keeping the momentum there. And it's easier to do nothing, isn't it? It's easier to say no, to let things carry on as they are, but to actually invest the time and the effort and do what the likes of Moya has done, it's tough, and you get doors slammed in your face and you get people resisting that change. So it's not easy, and football isn't, by far isn't the worst case scenario. It's better than a lot. The question I suppose I would ask, because that's my job, to sit here and ask questions, is I don't think there doesn't seem to be the rationalised decision yet as to how should the women's game interact with the men's game in helping women's football forward. Men's football is by far the bigger brand. The club game particularly is the most powerful. The best men's players have the power here. I don't know whether FIFA is doing enough to hold the men's game accountable, to give them the responsibility to say, come on, what are you going to do to help promote the women's game?
You want to try that on Moya? And then we'll get your comments, sir. Just a quick one from Moya.
This is a great question, because this comes back to why we need a FIFA. This comes back to why FIFA is important. And FIFA's charter is to develop the game. To develop the game in all corners of the earth and all corners of the demographic. And we do pretty well at cross-subsidising geographically. The structure incentivises us to do that, right? We do a less good job of developing all corners of the demographic, because there is no structural incentive to do that, because the people who aren't getting funded, i.e. the women, don't vote, right? So what is going to hold the organisation to account to do, as its charter says, develop all corners of the demographic? And this is why you need a FIFA, because that's its task. Left to its own devices, you know, the water is not going to run uphill. The water is not going to go from the men's professional end of the game to the grassroots of the game or to the development opportunities in the game like women or youth football or futsal. It's not going to go there of its own accord. It goes there because a global governing body makes that happen, and it's part of our charter to make that happen. So, you know, I'd rather be women's football than women's rowing or hockey or something where you didn't have this enormous, gargantuan men's game that spins off money like there's no tomorrow. I'd much rather be a game where we're part of that and we've got the opportunity to also make football the biggest game in the world for women. That's the challenge, and I think it should be achievable if we put our minds to it, if we sit down to write a clear strategy, a clear operational plan, and set a clear budget to make that happen. We should be able to do that within 5 or 10 years because we have the biggest game in the world on us in our corner, making it happen. And as I say, I'd much rather be women's football than women's any other sport if it's my ambition to be the biggest sport in the world. And it is, and it should be.
You know, let me just add, I mean, I agree with you on two things you said. One is this is really hard. And second is the men's game can have a positive role. We had a game last night in Orlando, which drew 61,000 people in MLS. That was fourth or fifth biggest attendance anywhere in the world this past weekend. That's terrific. The Orlando team has started a women's team in our league this year. We now have three MLS teams. They will be the three best operated because of the resources they're putting against it. One of them, and this we need a few more of, by the way, is actually profitable for their women's program. All right, so we have a not a standalone, but a women's professional soccer team that's profitable. In the first case, I twisted the owner's arm pretty hard to do it. The second one, we didn't need to do it because he saw the results. And third, Orlando did it on their own. And so we've got a model where MLS is investing in some teams, synergies, stadium use, all of that, that's extraordinarily positive. And hopefully we'll get a few more, and a few will be standalone teams. It's a little bit what David Stern did in the WNBA, and he single-handedly willed professional basketball on the women's side in the United States.
Mm. Let's get the comments. Yes, sir?
Yeah, it's Piara Power from the FAIR Network, and I wanted to echo the respect and congratulations that everybody's offered to those inside FIFA, Soraya, Moya, and those outside that were pushing for these reforms. They're clearly going to be very significant. But I think I want to come back to Sunil's point, if I can, which is about how we really do drive these down to association level, because that's really where the change will occur. Mm-hmm. I think Sunil set out some of the dilemmas, and I think you built on that, Moya, but what is the time frame and what are the mechanics of doing this? Because it's clear that if we wait for cultural change, that cultural change is not going to come easily or very quickly. So it needs to be one of those mandatory things that comes from on high. And how do we do that? Do we just say one day, in 2 years' time, in 18 months' time, every single association must have X number of women on their exco, and then roll that down through their committees? It's the mechanics I'm looking for.
So this is a much easier question to answer when the president is out of the room. We can bind him to certain things. Listen, there's a lot of different ways to do this. Funding, Donna talked about it earlier, whether it's carrot or stick. Service in various organizations. We've got committees. Well, if you want to serve on a certain committee, your member association has to follow certain rules. So this is going to take a little bit of time. It's not going to happen overnight. Johnny's run on a platform, partly that he believes more funding is available to the MAs. There's no reason some of that can't be targeted funding, or carrot or stick, or you've got to do X is automatic and Y is do additional programs in this area, a Title IX type approach for resources. And for countries like Germany or the US or England, whether it's $250,000 or $1 million isn't going to make that much of a difference. But guess what? For 150 or 160 countries, my guess is that we spend more in the US, and again, we're unique, like some other countries are in Europe especially, we spend more on our women's program than probably 175 countries in the world have in their budgets overall. Right? That's a guess. But it's not 170. So $1 million or $600,000 makes a big difference for a lot of countries. That gives you a pretty big stick or carrot, if we're going to go Donna's way, to get things done. To get things done, they're generally agreed upon. I mean, you talked about governance issues. This wasn't a lot of rocket science in these governance proposals. I mean, Sylvia's done this 1,000 times. So hopefully we can continue some of that, but it won't be easy, for sure.
Moya?
I'll add one thing to that. I mean, I think what Sunil says is right. FIFA hands out a lot of money. It redistributes wealth. It can redistribute on conditions that certain targets are met. Challenge grants, for example, is an idea where you do a bit, we do a bit. You know, once you're spending 10 or 20% of your budget on women's, we'll throw in another bunch of money. That kind of thing is all, I think, open for discussion. But there's another important point which I mentioned as part that was part of Gianni's response to the survey when he was running for president, was a gender equality audit. Now, this is about FIFA leadership in the first place. This is about FIFA saying, we commit to being a best practice gender equality firm, sports organisation in the world. We're going to have a policy for best practice gender equality within these walls, and we're going to audit ourselves once every couple of years. We'll make the results public, right? So everyone can see what we promised to do, what we actually did, and then what we need to fix to make it so. And that would be, if that were done, that would be a strong signal of leadership, because there is a lot that is copied. It's the power of the pulpit. And our example in this House is an example to every member association, and I think that is one of the, you know, leaving dollars aside, that is one of the most powerful things we could do to promote gender equality throughout the world.
Hmm. Another question or comment? Okay, so the microphone is making its way there. One for you, Sylvia. We've been talking the figures and the numbers that have been put forward. 6 women minimum in the future FIFA Council. Do you believe that this will really bring about change?
Well, I hope it will not be 6 all the time. It's just the minimum. We've already several times today, so should be more. We already have now 2 elected, as far as I understood, when it was only 1 minimum, so there was already an increasement. So that should be the goal for the future. Whether they bring change, they will change the culture, for sure. But whether they bring political change and whether they have a real big impact, that depends, of course, on these women. Whether there will be women with power like Moya, 6 Moyas will make a real difference. That's too much
five
for you. Maybe, too
five.
Much.
5 quantitative limit on Moya.
Well, with
sorry.
Lydia and some others as well. I think that's important to find the right persons, because always, whether it's women or men, you have the right persons and the wrong persons. So, what I think is you have a big pool of very good women in football. That's a big advantage you have in this sport. And then it's about the circumstances, whether they really can work as they want, whether they have people outside in this Congress and in all the national and continental federations to work with, because it's never just those in one body. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you need a network. We need a girls' network now, not just the old boys' network, but now a girls' or women network to work together with people even outside the sport, yeah, not just within football, what we have just started here now with this Congress. Mm. And then it's up to all of us to help you, and with helping FIFA, I'm sure FIFA will help other sports and other organizations. So it's a win-win-win situation, and we have to work on it.
Mm. Amanda?
I think one thing that I learned in the course of the run-up to Congress, which a lot of people don't know, is that the women put forward for the FIFA Council don't have to be an executive from a national association. They have to fit the criteria of being a woman in football. But actually, I found that quite interesting, that broadens the pool. Yes, they have to be put forward by their confederation and given the backing, but it opens up the pool for coaches, for senior players, and that, by definition, will broaden the perspective of people on that council, which can only be a good thing.
Mm. Sarah, you want to add to that? I see you nodding.
No, yeah, I agree with you, Sylvia, is that, you know, it's very important that the women that are there, you know, are very good women who are able to speak up and who are able to push, you know, to push our agenda. But the other thing is, it's not just the 6 women on the council who will make the difference. There has to be women at every level, in all the committees, in the standing committees, in the executive bodies of the member associations, in the confederations. That's where the change will happen. And, you know, the representation has to be filtered right throughout, all the way down, right to the members. That's where we'll see the change.
Mm. We've got a question, yes? Go ahead, sir.
Thank you very much. My name is Brendan Schwab. I'm the head of UniWorld Athletes, the global player association across all of sport, including, of course, football, through our FIFA Pro. I'd like to reiterate the congratulations of the audience and the group, not only for the decisions of last week, but in particular the quality of this conference. This session, of course, is about governance, and so we talk about quotas and folk, and I understand that they're important issues. But I think I'd be interested in the view of the panel. If our mission is to make football the biggest game for women, which I think is eminently achievable, then we need to attract the best talented athletes in the world. And in order to attract the most talented athletes in the world so that we can compete, say, with the benchmark, which is tennis, we need to create wealth. And I don't think we're going to create enough wealth for football, or women's football, if it is waiting for simply grants or distributions from the wealth of the men's game, even though that's an essential aspect of the overall picture. So my question is a governance one. How should football be governed so that the people in this room whose mission in life is to create the greatest possible opportunity for women in football and for women's football, how should the game be governed so that we can maximise the commercial return from women's football through the content, through the audiences that we've seen, so that it's generated directly back into the game and the game becomes self-sustaining? And therefore, the questions about how do we get involved are solved, because there's more jobs, there's more opportunities, there's more organisations, there's more committees to sit on, there's more boards. So I think that's the question, and we have it'd be very interested in people's response to that.
I wish I had the answer to part of that, because when we talk about professional anything, right, the distinguishing factor is not whether you think you're a professional, but can you earn a living at it? And let's face it, we don't have too many women's leagues or women's teams in the world where that's possible. Abby and I talked about this a lot yesterday. We've started to do that in the U.S., and we have 320 million relatively affluent, well-fed population in a rich country with a lot of facilities and so on. But it's still not there yet. We probably have 35 or 40 players in our league that can earn a living at it. We have one other very big difference, though, which we do attract the best athletes because of something that happened 50 years ago called Title IX. The big payoff there is not necessarily a job, but it is a four-year scholarship that's worth $250,000, perhaps. And in the absence of professional sports, and we don't have a lot of those in the women's side, team sports, that's still a very big payoff. In the NBA, WNBA now, we've got some of that. But there aren't too many players in the U.S. even that are saying, I want to go and play soccer at college because I can play in the NWSL. Hopefully that'll happen over time as the economic rewards change. But right now it's still about, I want to go be Abby Wambach and play in the Women's World Cup, which may have economic rewards for a very small group. But that you've just hit the hardest part of this. It's got to make economic sense. It's got to make commercial sense. It can't be a charity. It doesn't stack up very well against Save the Children or cancer research. At the beginning, it can be a social cause to get it moving, but eventually, it's got to make business sense. And it can, I think. There are some models where it does. We start off very slowly with U.S. soccer putting a lot of money behind it because we're not in the business of making a profit, so we weren't looking for that. It's an investment. And hopefully, over time, we'll get there. But it has to make economic sense. The Women's World Cup now does make economic sense. Our national team now makes economic sense. Maybe not when we measure all the development money we put in, but 10 years ago it certainly didn't make economic sense. But a long-term investment paid off. We're now getting bigger crowds. But something Amanda touched on, and we should all be cognizant of it, whether it's the reforms or the high of the Women's World Cup, it dissipates pretty quickly. But you're at a different level. You're at a higher plateau. So our attendances, whether it was in our league or for our women's national team, after the Women's World Cup skyrocketed, then they fell. But they're at a higher plateau, they're a higher level than before, and we need to keep it up. And the same is true for our league. So I wish I knew an easy way to get that. In the richest country in the world, we struggle to make that happen right now.
If you compare women's football to men's football, you have a huge gap. But if I look to Germany and I compare women's football to all the other female sports, well, there is women football and there is handball and hockey and others. So the women in football already have overtaken all other sports, at least in Germany and I think in quite many other countries as well. So there is already a development, but still place for improvement. And I think we heard from you, Barbara, quoting the spectators, that there are less women watching women's football than men's football. So, well, we have to do something about that. And then we have to look to the sponsors. If we look especially to the sporting goods industry, they know nowadays that the big improvement or the big growth for sporting goods is with women. So that's why they are attracted, I think, by women's sports. So we have to find a way to put all these observations together and see how to have a strategy to work on sponsors, on broadcasters, on spectators, to bring them all together. But it will not happen automatically. It needs some work, and I think it needs something like a strategic body within FIFA to work on this, how to develop women's football.
I would add one thing, and I would say a consistent, sustained effort and focus on growing the women's game will grow the women's game like you've never seen before. It's always suffered from being this little thing in the shadow of an enormous men's game, and it was everybody's fifth or tenth priority when they were running men's football. If it is the dedicated focus, if you give women's football the focus and the structure to flourish, it will flourish. Nothing ever got anywhere with a stop-start kind of effort. Mm. And I think that is something FIFA can lead on, but we see it. You see it happening in increments all over the world, but a consistent effort is what will yield results. Nothing succeeds like some success, and nothing happens without focus.
Mm. And it's a collaborative effort, isn't it, Amanda? I mean, if you look at the roles that all the different stakeholders have to play. I mean, we spoke about corporate, we're speaking about the media. Everyone has an important role to play to help this.
Yeah, and I think the media is guilty of not doing enough for women's sport. I think partly women's sport in the past hasn't done enough to help itself. But I mean, if I look at, I have a daily half an hour world sport show. To fill that daily half an hour world sports show, in terms of women that we would mention, Serena Williams and Lindsey Vonn and a women's World Cup finals, I'm ashamed to say that would probably be it. We would probably do, out of five parts in half an hour, we have a lot of ad breaks, three would be football, but they would be the men's game. And that needs to change, but the argument then is how does that change? And how do the women portray themselves to make that change? And then you get into the issue of, do we just objectify women because of how they look, or do we actually tell their stories? But then you wouldn't interview a man about that part of his career, so why should you ask a woman about that? And the lines are blurred, and nobody is really quite is sure where they are at the moment. Social media is helping to make female sports stars' personalities, but it's a hard balance, and I don't know the answer, I have to say.
Mm. We'll get another. Okay, you've got the microphone.
Yeah, I've got the mic. Yeah, thank you. So, Magic Cruz Blanco from FIFA, and I'm going to put Sunil on the spot again. We're talking about walking the talk and making sure that the reforms are implemented. And obviously, FIFA and the confederations are expected to lead the way, but the reality is that this change is going to happen at the member associations, on the ground, where every little single girl and woman that want to play football will need to have the chance. And presidents of member associations have a big power to make sure that this happened. Last week we were in Amsterdam, Carl-Erik Nilsson from the Swedish FA, the president, he said that the only committee that he shares in his association is the diversity committee, and he has 50% women and 50% men there. So he's championing diversity and equality within his association. Now, you are one of the most successful presidents in women's football, let's say, and within FIFA.
Won the World Cup.
Yes. Yes.
Three times.
Indeed.
Three times.
So you are the champion.
I have a world champion. And
exactly.
One of.
So you are the champion. You're one of them. Let's give credit to others,
okay.
I think. Yes.
Okay. You got me riled up with that, but all right.
So you are indeed very proud, but I would like to ask you, what would you say to the other 208 presidents of FIFA member associations that they should do to bring women's and girls' football forward? And what decision are you proud of that have taken you as a president to be the most successful one today? Because you are the champion, yes.
Thank you for ending that way. Look, first of all, I'd be humbled about it, contrary to what I just said about being wrong. We have a long way to go in the US. We're not where I want to be. We're certainly not where Abby wants to be, whether that's in composition of our board and our committees, or almost any other area.
Where we are very successful is participation. 45 to 48% of our registered players are female, along with Canada and FIFA, when they do their survey, lists us separately, those two. We are very successful, in my view, in what we've done with our elite programs, but still a long way to go. We have national teams at virtually every age group on boys and girls, men and women. And our women's team is obviously recognized, and we had, you know, yesterday during our dinner, we had three national teams playing at the same time. Three women's national teams playing at the same time that I was following on Twitter. As it turns out, they all won in shutouts, just as a matter of record for everyone else. What would I advise? The only way you're going to get there is by spending more resources, having more women at the table, and with a voice. I have to admit, you know, I thought I was sensitive to this, some of these issues, and I got more sensitized last night even. Because the only time I speak generally to a group that's got only women in it, or mostly women in it, is when I speak to the women's national team, or maybe my daughter's team. Yesterday, at the dinner, and the pre-dinner cocktail party, was a bit awkward. Right? And I mean that. Right? Because it was only half a dozen men there, and it got me thinking about some of the issues that you've all said, absolutely. How do you network if you're in that situation? And I've been in that situation very often. And not only a lot of women, but a lot of women who knew the topic very well, very smart women, passionate women about a particular subject. So after a little while, without any alcohol, it got a little bit easier. But how do you do that? It's only by getting people in decision-making power to give up a little bit of that power, to share that power, to get people like Moya, like Sonia, like Lydia. I mean, and Sylvia touched on it. So we've got three record breakers here in all three of them. So Lydia was the first female EXCO member ever. Sonia was the first non-dedicated seat. She's in a non-dedicated seat. I'm not going to say she's in a male seat, because it didn't belong to any male, but she's in a non-dedicated seat at FIFA. And Moya, obviously, you've seen everything that she's been involved in. So we, you know, some of the smartest people I know in soccer are women. Some of the best people I know in soccer are women. So when we make decisions, it's not based on them being male or female. They're generally, quite often, they're the best people. We're going to still need some quotas. My limit on Moya quotas is 5. I want to repeat that. But we're going to still need help there, for sure. U.S. soccer still needs to do a lot of things. But elements like the Swedish president giving you that, and the Scandinavian countries have been very good in most of these areas. It's going to take some time to touch on. There's a whole bunch of countries out of 209 where girls aren't allowed to play or go to a game or whatever it might be. Those are very different problems. I don't have any easy advice for that. I can't, you know, sit here and say, my experience means you should do this. But we followed a lot of experience, whether it was Billie Jean or Donna's experience, and had the help of American law on our side, had a women's movement that was earlier than many places, had some incredible athletes and role models. And I have no doubt that in other countries, with a relatively small investments, you'll see great rates of return, and that will help you reinvest and figure this out. Mm.
Sunil, we're going to say goodbye to you very, very shortly.
It wasn't that bad of a comment. I mean, Jesus.
Thank you so much. We're going to say goodbye very shortly. We'll take your comment just now, Sarai. A quick one. Tell us, what more is FIFA doing to support women's football? I mean, there were the 10 key FIFA development principles, but what more, you know, with the reforms as well? Just a quick one.
I'd like to comment about what FIFA's doing that's not in the reforms. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, before this whole reform and the crisis and all that happened, there was a lot, and there still is a lot happening that FIFA is doing for women in football. I mean, there is an entire catalogue of women's development programs that are available to the member associations around the world, and it's something that Margie and her team work very, very hard day in and day out to push down through our member associations. Here we go, perfect slide for what I'm talking about. I wanted to recognise that, and you know, throughout this whole scandal, if that's what we want to call it, these things weren't recognised and these things weren't talked about, and a lot of people don't know about the good things that are actually happening. And you know, I'd like to say that I'm a result of those programs and those good things that filtered right down to the grassroots level, because that's where I came from, you know, and that's why I'm sitting here today. And I think that's important to remember, that the reforms are great. Everything that's coming with the reforms are excellent, but what we have now is also fantastic. Yeah.
Final comment before we say goodbye to Sunil.
Yes, Is this working? Yeah,
yep.
Now it works. Good afternoon, everyone. Andre Moita from upsides.ch. You don't know me, and that's why I'm talking. I want to add some perspective to this, because as much respect as I have for everyone in this room, you are all operating on a very big scale, a scale that women's football often isn't. And I just founded my own media company 6 months ago, and our goal was to cover women's football as much as we do men's football in Switzerland. And we have been struggling, and not for lack of effort, but the problem is we don't have material. It's really tough for us to do our research. We can't go traveling around the world and to every stadium. For instance, we were covering the Swiss women's national team when they were running up to the Euro qualifications. And when they played in foreign ground, we couldn't cover it because there were no pictures of it. There was often no radio. There was just like one text of it. And I don't have the resources, nor do I get someone to sponsor me the resources to that. And I think that's the main problem we have to address here, actually, at FIFA, and why we need the marketing people to be in that. Because we need to, maybe in developed countries, as Sunil said, where money makes different money, maybe we need to buy for each of the developed countries just some cameras for 10,000 of francs, and then just hand them around to the teams so there's at least one broadcasted game every week, so people can talk about it, people can watch it. We have YouTube, we have Facebook live streaming. I think it's really important that we encourage teams to also produce content nowadays, because otherwise the media won't get around to it because it just costs too much money.
Mm. Thank you so much for that comment. Yep. Final comment is to say goodbye to you.
Yeah, just put the slide back up. We just had the last two slides if we can. Mm-hmm. And here's the final comment, and excuse me, the two before this, all the metrics, with the exception of numbers of associations, nice numbers, we by tenfold before Mr. And those are terrific. FIFA staff, the rest of us, there is no reason those numbers shouldn't be a lot bigger and can be in a relatively short. The words are nice on paper, but we need some measurable things. There is, honestly, I'm looking at all of those, with the exception of number of member associations, tenfold by the time we're done in 3 years. Tenfold. We should do that. Thank you all. I've got to run. It's been a terrific conference. Congratulations to all of you that have been involved in this for such a long time.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. But we continue the conversation, and we also invite more of your comments or questions. Amanda, why is it that we aren't, you know, highlighting these success stories that Sarai was just speaking about? Why aren't we talking about some of the other good news stories coming out, the work that FIFA is doing more?
Yeah.
It's a difficult one, yeah.
Why not?
Yeah.
Because the bad news has got more traction. Hmm? The bad news is more interesting from a wider perspective. It's an easier sell. People like a bad story. People like to see people mess up in life. Sadly, that's the reality. It's across the news. It's across the news. It's death, destruction. It's very rarely the positive stories. And I can only put my hands up and say, you know, if we are holding a production meeting about the stories that we're going to cover that day, or if I have conversations with people here about good news stories, trying to sell those to the bosses to get the funding to do those is hard. Mm. It is hard.
You can come up and take Sunil's seat, by the way. Go ahead, Sarah.
I think I want to speak a little bit about that, but also to answer this gentleman's question, because I don't think it was really addressed. Mm. I'll take this opportunity to talk a little bit about a program that comes from FIFA, and I'm not sure if a lot of people know this, but almost every member association within FIFA has a media officer. And that is someone that is trained within the country and that is resourced through FIFA, down through the confederations, to cover all the media, the football, the women's, men's, all the activity of media within that member association. And I know in my region in particular, in Oceania, we used a FIFA program called Performance to do exactly what you said. We bought a camera and a kit officer in that country. It was relatively inexpensive when you look at the money that is made on a global scale. And through that, we now have, you know, I think at least half of our member associations are doing a weekly football show. And we are also getting footage sent back to our confederation every week that we can put together and push out. And, you know, these type of initiatives are really, really important because we need to get more women's football on TV. We've got to have it showing. And, you know, I just want you to know that there are things happening, and maybe this is an avenue for you, is to tap in to these media offices within the member countries.
I would like to add one point. We already talked about how to link men's football and women's football and let the men's football help develop women's football. And there's one point where you always have huge attention, that's a men's World Cup. And so make the development of women's football a criteria for the awarding of the men's World Cup. That's one point. And then link the World Cup to development issues with regard to female football in the specific country. I think then you have the big attention, like now for Rio, for the Olympics, for example. There's a lot going on in Brazil right now from different NGOs on working on youth sport and other things. And that's reported in the media. So if for the next World Cup, you have to link women's football to the men's World Cup. I think that gives a lot of attraction, and you have to use it as long as you have this big gap between men's football and women's football.
Mm. Got a comment at the top, yes?
Thank you. I think we've been hearing a lot of really good things in this last session. And as Moya said, we're 2-0 at halftime. Apart from cloning Moya, so she can write another book called How I Was Cloned, in addition to my life as a quota, how can we, in this room and with the support of our member associations, assist FIFA to prioritise the writing of the strategy? That's what we need. We need the strategy, we need it documented, and we need to have appropriate resourcing so that things can be put in action. So how can we help FIFA do that?
What?
Well, I wish Gianni was here for this one, because I think there's a lot of people who would love to help. I think there's a lot of people who see the commercial opportunity that awaits us, who sees the participation growth opportunity that awaits us, and who would be very willing to put their shoulder to the wheel to make it all happen. I think it's a matter of political will in the end. You know, it's a matter of political will. And if we're serious about this, if we want to make good on the promises that have been that we've heard through the reforms in the election process, then FIFA needs to do that. I mean, you know, FIFA's in a situation where it's not good enough anymore just to do a bit, you know, just to kind of do a bit to cover up some cracks and move on. FIFA needs to hit it out of the park to get its credibility back in a big way, and then that will solve a bunch of other problems as well on the revenue side. So, you know, to me, there's nothing I'd rather do for the rest of the year than work on bringing a women's football strategy to life for FIFA.
Got a question right at the back.
Yeah.
Okay. After you, we'll go to the gentleman at the back. Go ahead.
Okay, good afternoon. Actually, I'm going to step in because we were talking a lot about media. I'm working for Eurosports, which has been known, like Brigitte reminded this morning, that we try to support as much as possible women football. Mm-hmm. Actually, for us, the case right now, because since this morning, we talk a lot about national teams. Mm-hmm. And us at Eurosports, I wouldn't say that national teams are not the problem anymore, because we register really good ratings every time. Like every year, we have Olympic Games, Euro, World Cup. On this cyclic event, big events, where we are about to gather really huge crowds. But for us now, the main point, I guess, to keep on developing the sport, it's the storytelling. And mm-hmm. it's for us, the focus would be to, like AB said this morning, to create icons, to work on clubs, and to develop a fans community around clubs, because people right now, they are behind their teams. It's easy to be behind your teams when the teams is up to a really good result. if you want something more consistent, we need people to gather behind their clubs, behind Bayern Munich, behind Wolfsburg, behind Olympique de Lyon in France. That's really, like, for us, the problem right now is to build a strong fan community that feel that they belong, like as if you support Arsenal, FC Barcelona for men, we should have the same for women.
Mm-hmm. Nuenda? Yeah.
It strikes me that at the moment there is still a stronger connection in the women's game with the national side mm-hmm. than the club side, and that then is obviously harder to maintain because there's not the week in, week out following for the national team, but you can still have your national stars who are promoted, and absolutely that is how you tell the story. But the problem with women's sport, at which football is definitely up there, as I said, is that in this age of 24-hour news, there is so much news and so much sports news out there, and there is such an appetite for continuous updating of what is the latest line on X, Y, and Z. It has to be a really good, well-presented story to get there. And that's the difficulty.
Hmm. I might add a comment if I may. I think club football is the week in, week out football. It's what fills in all the gaps in between the World Cups and the international tournaments. And it's where most football is played and most football is watched. You know, men's football, when do you watch? You mostly watch clubs play week in, week out. And that taps into really deep tribal passions and the supporter base that is about clubs. It's about tribalism, and that's why the viewer ratings are high, that's why the money is high. I think that's ahead of us in women's football. I think it's an opportunity, but it's also, I think, an opportunity to rebrand it a bit, because there's an ugly side of that as well, which you see in men's football. And we don't really see that in women's football. I think we kind of attract a nicer crowd, actually, to the women's game. It's got different brand values. It's fresher. It's more true to the values of fair play and, you know, honest endeavour. It hasn't been affected by some of the more difficult elements of professionalism and difficult fans. I mean, there's not too many. I don't think I've ever seen a punch-up or anything at a women's match.
But is that at the expense of the passion at the moment behind it?
I think it remains to be seen. I mean, that's a question for human nature, you know. Do you have to be ugly to be passionate? I don't think so. You know, I think it can actually be good for football. It can lift football back to a higher stage. And that's really what you all fell in love with in the first place. It was a game that promised... it was a game where you came to be your best. You came to be excellent on the field or off it. You bring your best self to the field. And that has, you know, got lost along the way somewhere. But I think women's football in South America, it was very interesting talking to a lot of Brazilians during the World Cup there. They saw women's football as something that took them back 30 years to what they really loved about the game before it was spoiled. That was what the men in Brazil were saying to me. And I think this is an opportunity. I mean, football needs a new brand. It needs to be freshened up. And, you know, this is part of the answer.
Mm. Comment right at the back, sir.
My name is Edu Ajay. I represent two organizations, Acro Ghana and Swiss Minors. And I am happy to be here to listen to such discussions about women's football. What I have not seen or heard now is that the challenges in developing countries is not being spelled out in this conference. And with my experience, I'd want to, you know, throw more light on some of the challenges that developing countries are facing with regard to girls and women football. We have some taboos, cultures that really prevent us even to organize girls' games or football. There is also the point that much as mathematics is awarded points in school, we should also try to consider sports also getting marks, so that will be attractive to the parents to allow girls also to participate in sport and in football. Because by us in back my home country, football is the easiest game that could be played. Mm.
Because with one football, you have 22 spectators, everybody watching. And that is one of the only source of entertainment we also enjoy. At this level, I want to have this message across that FIFA should also consider working with educational groups so that they could also award points for sport in schools like mathematics, geography, and all the other sport disciplines. 2013, I was also in the UN, and during the UN Women's Day, one issue came up, and that is about girls' menstruation. This is also a big problem in developing areas, because girls will not go out like boys without shirts to play football. Girls need to be dressed properly before they can go out. During their periods, they suffer a lot because they don't have the hygienic materials to apply because parents don't have the money to give them. So please look at these areas and note also that in developing countries, the birth rate is much, much higher than in developed countries. So it means if we want to have future for women football, then we have to consider this as a challenge in these areas. I therefore also invite people who are interested in my girls' football to join me, to collaborate, that we can work on one particular issue about this girls' menstruation things. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for sharing your experience, which is what we've been doing throughout the day. More questions coming?
One comment in response to that. Thank you for raising your hand and discussing these things, because the development opportunity in the developing world is massive. Mm. It's massive. I mean, it's not just getting more sportswomen playing football or more fans interested. It's getting women active at all. And when you talk about educational institutions and we're talking about government policies here, and I think there's a massive opportunity for FIFA to show leadership by engaging with governments at a policy level around girls and sport. I mean, I think this is a massive opportunity for FIFA to be a leader. And, you know, we talk about government interference in sport. Well, how about sport, you know, does it back the other way a little bit and starts to guide government policies to enable its girl population to be more actively engaged in sport. They'll be more actively engaged in education, in the workforce, and in society. And that is a huge economic opportunity and productivity growth opportunity for the developing world.
We're going to get our comments shortly. Sylvia, just a quick one. What challenges for improving women's leadership in football on a national level do you see? Because we're talking about, you know, so much of the spotlight in the women's game being thrust on the national level.
Well, when I look to Germany, football is, with regard to women's leadership, I think the best sport, because we have a national coach and other coaches for the youth level as well, and we already have it for years now in Germany, the second or third one already. It's a department led by a woman in Germany. But up to now, we have no real leadership of women in men's football or on the overall football. And I think that's very important, that women take over responsibility for football on the whole, for the whole federation, and not just for the women's department. And so there we need, well, some improvement, or at least we need not just to focus on women's football, that's important, to develop the game, but then it's important to take over responsibility for the whole. And we have only one woman up to now in the board in Germany. And I think, looking now to FIFA, we have to work on that. And I think it's similar in quite many federations, not just in other continents, but as we heard from Sunil, they have some problems in the US still, and we have the same in middle of Europe. Mm.
Go ahead, ma'am.
It's Sally Hancock from the UK. I'm the chair of Women in Sport and also a sponsorship consultant. And I just wanted to touch on a slightly separate point to that which has been covered so far today, and that's to do with the commercial rights around women's sport. In the UK, or rather in England, in the last few years, we've seen the men's rights in sponsorship and television separate out from the women's rights. What this has meant is that some forward-thinking and ambitious sponsors have come into the women's game in football, invested in it and concentrated its efforts in women's football. And we've seen an increase in participation, and we've seen a massive increase in coverage as well. Recently, I brought an energy company, or one of the biggest ones actually, into the women's game for a 4-year deal. They're not sponsoring the men's game, and they're doing it as a part of their responsibility agenda as an organization. And it's telling a story about their diversity commitments as an organization. So my question to you is whether, in the longer term, you would consider separating out the men's rights from the women's rights in the game, in order to find partners that will be ambitious and help to grow the game with you. Thank you.
Who's going to tackle Moya? Yeah?
I think we want to maximise the value of the rights, because that's what will bring revenues into the game. That's what it will enable people to play it instead of as a hobby, but as a job. What is the best way to maximise revenues out of sports rights? In some cases, bundling it maximises it. In some cases, you separate it. We've seen the same in new media. Do you separate your TV rights from your digital rights? These are, I guess, specific to the market that you're selling into, so I wouldn't want to say there's a right or a wrong way, and of course these things are evolving all the time. I think in the tennis world, we learnt many years ago when Billie Jean King was active that there was a market for women's sport. I think that there are benefits. I think the Swedish league initially bundled their women's league rights with their men's league rights, and I think it might have come with a must-carry obligation as well, so that really uplifted the women's league to a state where it had an audience of its own, and then they were split away. So there's all kinds of ways to do it. New media's in play as well, but I think the key is that the rights are to be valued. They shouldn't be thrown in for nothing, because they're not worth nothing. They're worth something, and more people are watching it.
I just want to add to that. I just want to quickly touch on what you said, how you had a sponsor come on board specifically for the women's game because they had some gender targets that they needed to meet. And I think this is something that we need to be quite strategic about. We need to use that, because it's no secret that, you know, in the corporate world now, and, you know, many global organisations, is that they have these gender targets and corporate social responsibility targets. And part of those targets are all based around women. And women's football is an excellent platform for these corporates and these organizations to meet those targets. So we've got to think strategically, okay, how can we get people like the sponsor on board with us to put more funding in, to help elevate, to help push the game forward? We've got to start looking outside the box, and this is one area where we can really make an impact.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have a question regarding how you get to implementation. And the question is quotas versus targets. And we've talked about it a little bit. We've heard different perspectives, and people have... I found that people don't have a lukewarm opinion on this. You either feel very strongly about one versus the other. What I'd like to know is does anybody want to comment on how they feel about quotas versus targets? And if targets, how do you get there? And if quotas, at what point do you not need them anymore?
I can probably say, you know, from my side, me personally, it had nothing to do with targets or quotas. I mean, it was just me slogging away and getting through there and working my way up. And, you know, there are many, many women in here who have reached the position they are and who will without the quotas. But if it wasn't for the quotas, then I wouldn't have had an amazing mentor in Moya sitting on the executive committee, and there wouldn't be, you know, so many women who are put in positions because of the quota who are leading the way now. So I think it's a bit of a balance. I hope that in the future it becomes so normal to see women that you don't need a quota. I think that's what we're all aiming for. But I think until we get there, it's important that we do have them, because, you know, we've got to have that balance.
I think we should be clear, though, right now, apart from the six in the FIFA Exco, we don't have either a quota or a target in these reforms. We've got neither. Okay. So I would say either would be great. What we have is statements of principle. We should have some appropriate female representation on our standing committees. We should have regard to the importance of gender equality when we constitute legislative bodies at the Confederation level and the member level. But none of that is a target and none of that is a quota. I think at a minimum targets are important, because if you don't have a target, what are you aiming for? Mm. If you can't answer that question, what am I aiming for, then you're probably not doing anything meaningful. So that, as a minimum, I think you need to have something that you're aiming for. I understand there are cultural issues, it's a diverse world out there, but in my case, I wouldn't be here but for a quota. I would not be here but for a quota.
And then you have always had quotas within FIFA, continental quotas, quotas for the English people, and so there are a lot of quotas. And so we shouldn't be ashamed, being women, to profit from a quota. Others do as well, and they don't mind, and they don't even discuss it.
And you would still like 30%?
Well, we've heard all the theory about 30%. 30% is the right number to get it to tip, to the point where you don't have to, it starts looking after itself at that point. So I believe that 30%, I put it in the submission, I believed it then and I believe it now.
Okay, we're going to get closing remarks from the panellists, and we'll get two questions in particular for the President. Just to
welcome back.
To get the closing, okay, well, there's the microphone already. So our first question, go ahead.
Oh yeah, okay, in particular to the President. So my name is Esther Franke, I work for an organisation called Discover Football. We're a global network from women active in football. And we also discuss different perspectives on our dreams for women's football. And we've heard a lot about how to put more money in the women's game. And I do think it's very important, but I'm also a little afraid of capitalization. Because I don't want to see a Women's World Cup that forces people to leave their homes, like it happened in Brazil, for example, and trades players just like goods for millions and millions and millions of euros or dollars or whatever. So my question goes to all of you, but also, of course, to the President. Where do you also see limits to capitalization in women's football in order to keep ethics standards and in order to keep it a sports game to enjoy and not just a capitalized market?
Well, I think one doesn't necessarily need to go without the other. I think ethical standards have to be there, whether you speak about money in football or you speak about grassroots, whether you speak about the top professional or the base of football. I think if we are serious about developing women's football, the women's game, then even more than what it is already now, of course, if we are serious about that, then we must look at both. We must look at the top professional side of it, at the top competitions, because this is the locomotive. This is what triggers and will bring the revenues to reinvest as well in football, but will bring also the popularity and the, the will for more women to embrace football as well. On the other side, we have to invest, of course, as well on the grassroots, on the bases, on the girls, football, on the amateur part of the game. But we have to develop both elements without any fear. And of course, when we speak about money, we have to speak about ethics at the same time. But I don't see this as two things which cannot go with each other. Personally as well, I am, I'm against charity in the sense of women's football doesn't need charity. Women's football is a sport, is football on its own. So what we have to focus on is, of course, to make sure that revenues grow around women's football, because then we can invest much more in women's football, rather than going to ask the men, please give us something to develop. Of course we have to invest in football. And when I speak about kids, boys and girls, it's the same. Women and men is the same. Investment in grassroots football is the same. But I think there must be a known dignity for the women's game, who has to stand on its own. And we have to work on that. We have to develop that. We were speaking about tennis as well before. Well, that's what was developed. Why it's not possible in football? It must be possible in football as well.
We're going to get the closing comments now, and then just one more question for the President. We'll start off with you, Sylvia, your closing comment, a call to action, way forward.
Well, I think it's a big starting point with the reform for FIFA right now, and we have heard that the reform process was a chance for the women, and now I think the women are a chance for the reform process to really be fulfilled, and I think that's what we all have to work on, women and men, all together. And what I just said before in the last round, women have to take over responsibility for the whole. And I think that's the task we have right now.
Thank you so much. Sarah?
My vision for women's football and women in football is for it to be a total norm and a minimum expectation that 50% of the women in the room are women, and that the income generated from a Women's World Cup is the same, if not more, than from the Men's World Cup, you know. And in order for this to happen, and I think something that is very important that each and every one of the people in this room and those that are watching from home can do, is to really be a champion for it. Because we've seen, you know, reforms and women pushed into these positions where they can do a great thing. But it doesn't become a norm until people start to see the success of it. We need people to see what the achievements are of having a woman in a leadership position or in that decision-making body. So if you see something on the ground in your member association or in your club or to the media, you know, within your country, you've got to be a champion for it and get it out there and let people see these are the successes that can come from having more women represented within football. It's really important to push, and everyone can do that.
Thank you so much. We've got our final question at the back, right? Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, my name is Solomon. I work at FIFA. I guess my question is linked more to what the panel's opinion is. I think one thing that we touched on was how important club football is the lifeblood of the daily football that we watch on our televisions. And my question really to the panel is, how can we integrate the existing infrastructure and the existing challenges that we have within men's football and allow those to achieve the issues that have arisen in women's football? For example, we have a club licensing system. Is there any way that clubs can be obliged to have not only junior boys teams but also girls teams at the same time? So is the advancement of women's football a parallel process to more professionalization within the men's football?
President?
Well, I think definitely the development and the real boost of women's football will go also through club football. For this, we have to look already at what is happening and also at what the potential can be. I think we have seen, in particular also in Europe, some clubs who have embraced, some top professional clubs who have embraced women's football and have now created women's team and teams, and this is developing fast and well, and it gives also a popularity or a new boost to football, and we have to use this as well. And club licensing is a very good tool, I think. I don't like the word oblige, but push certainly clubs to do more in women's football. So I think if we can do that, and if we can follow what has already started and push it a little bit all over the world, then we'll have some great results.
Thank you. Amanda, your closing comment?
I think it's a word that's been used lots today, and that's opportunity. And football has been battered like never before in the last 10, 11, 12 months. And this is an opportunity for women's football not just to develop itself, but to really change people's perceptions and fall in love again with football. But the key for me is accountability and real tangible targets and deadlines and actually making these reforms happen. And that's going to be the tough bit. But it's about momentum, taking this moment and going with it.
Thank you. Moya?
I can't add a lot to that. You know, it's half time. The game is what we make it. I mean, the best way to change the future is to create it, and it's all there in front of us. The opportunity is there to create history and to change the world.
Mm. A round of applause, ladies and gents, for our panelists. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sylvia, Sarai. Thank you so much, Amanda, Moya. As we reach the end of the formalities today, I'd like to now call on the president of FIFA, President Infantino, just to round things up with his closing comments. Thank the you. Panel is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Well, here we are. Here we are at the end of an exciting day, at the end of a very interesting day. From what I hear and from what I've seen myself, it has been a truly fruitful day. I mean, the future is ahead of us, as Moya says, and an opportunity is there, and we have to write the new page of women football and women in football. And we are here for that, and I think it started today. It started, okay, with the reforms and with the points, which with the new articles in the statutes, which, in which we are obliged and we have to do something. But it started as well for me personally today, and for all of you, by listening, because this is the basis. We have first to listen and to learn and to get your input on what we should be doing in order to do it right, because it will not help us to do something if we get it wrong. And for this reason, these meetings, these conferences like today are extremely, extremely important, because it gives us the input that we need. And believe me, it is not just another conference, it is not just another meeting, it is not just another panel discussion. What has been discussed here, what has been said here, will be worked out, will be elaborated into some concrete proposals that will help us to move forward. I said it in my campaign, I can repeat it now, women football and women in football is a priority, has to be a priority for football. It is not part of the problem, that's right, it's part of the solution for the future of football. And we've always to remember. I said as well, I don't like to impose dictates, to impose obligations, but sometimes we have to go there as well a little bit. But we need to have targets. We need to have objectives, and we need to work on that. We need to work on having more women in the council. We have already an increase of 600%. That's fantastic. But it's not this. Of course, it's not this. We have to look into all the bodies. It's a minimum of six. It must be more. In all the other committees, we have to look into increasing women representation. Is 30% the right target? If you say it, probably yes. Well, let's look into that. Let's analyze it. Let's put ambitious targets and let's see where we get to, and let's see what we can achieve. But we have to achieve something which is clear and which is significant and which makes a real difference. We have to develop the commercial side as well of women's football. The World Cup, the Women's World Cup, is a great competition. It is a great competition which has a great potential, and we have to work on that as well. And if this means that at the beginning we have to invest some resources, then we will have to do that. We have to look at the clubs in terms of club licensing, in terms of club competitions. In UEFA, we started the Champions League when I was General Secretary. And it started slowly, and it's getting better and better and better. And we have to look into all of these things to see how we can improve the game, and we have to do it seriously. We have to allocate the right and the necessary resources to do that, but more than that, we have to allocate and put into it the necessary passion and commitment that is needed. You will have the passion and the commitment from my side, this you can be sure. As I said, however, already in the introduction, alone I cannot do anything. I will need your help and your support to do the right thing. And I count on you for that, and I thank you for coming here today. Thank you very much. finished?
It's finished, yeah. We thank the president as well. And a big thank you to all of you for being involved, for talking to us on the social media platforms. So as the president rightfully said, I mean, this was the perfect platform to see how far we've come on this wonderful journey and to continue the upward momentum and take women's football and women in football to the next level. Thank you all. And enjoy lunch that will be served downstairs.
Dinner. Almost.
Oh, dinner. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Great job.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.